Amen. What a wonderful thing this morning, if you can sing that with some truthfulness, that our victory lies in Jesus. It's not what we've done, but what He's already accomplished. We should be able to rejoice in that. There's nothing any better to know that the work is done, finished, and we don't have to worry about that part of it. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, we ask you to turn to the book of Numbers. Numbers chapter 21, and we're going to begin reading in the very first verse. Numbers chapter 21, and we're going to begin reading in the very first verse. The Bible says, "And when King Arad, the Canaanite, which dwelt in the south, heard tell that Israel came by the way of the spies, he took some of them prisoners. He fought against Israel and took some of them prisoners. And Israel vowed a vow unto the Lord and said, If thou wilt indeed deliver this people unto my hand, then I will utterly destroy their cities. And the Lord hearkened to the voice of Israel and delivered up the Canaanites and utterly destroyed them and their cities. And he called the name of the place Hormah. And they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom. And the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way. And the people spake against God and against Moses, Wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no bread, neither is there any water, and our soul loatheth this light bread. And the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much of the people died. And therefore, the people came to Moses and said, We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that he may take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said unto Moses, Make thee a fiery serpent, and set it upon a pole, and it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. And Moses made a serpent of brass, and he put it upon a pole. And it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived." I'd like to preach, the Lord being my helper this morning, How Well Do You See? Dear Lord, we thank You and praise You for another opportunity to be in Thy house this morning. We count it a privilege and a great honor to be able to meet among Your people this morning. And we pray that we'd ever understand this and we'd never take it lightly. Lord God, we beg and beseech You this morning that You might meet with us. We need that. We need to know that when we've left this place, it's been good to be in the house of the Lord. Lord God, we pray that You fill this place with Your presence. Lord, convict the lost of their need. Lord, show them that they might understand that You're the only way for redemption this morning. We pray that You would save the lost. And Lord, the saved that meet with us, Lord, that You would encourage us in the way that we might understand and know that all things are after the counsel of Your own will and nothing's taken You by surprise. And that You would remind us of that from time to time. And we pray these things in the sweet and the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Now, apparently familiar verses of Scripture, but I do want to review it again. Because it shows how quickly we can go from victory to defeat. It shows how from one moment that seemingly we can be winning in the things of this world in a spiritual sense, and in the next moment be very defeated in the way that we present. And it begins, "And when King Arad, the Canaanite, which dwelt in the south, heard tell that Israel came by the way of spies, he fought against Israel." Now, if there is a victory happening, you can bet that Satan and his crowd knows about it. If the Lord is meeting with His people, you can mark it down. The devil knows about it. Now, if you're just having one of those little pitiful services and you're only here because it's Sunday and you have no craving for the things of God, don't get disturbed, because Satan could care less. You know what you've reduced yourself to? Nothing but religion. And religion will send a soul to hell. But if you are meeting with God and God's meeting with you, let me say this: look out, trouble's on the way. Because there's nothing that God, that the devil hates worse is when God meets with God's people. He despises it. And the reason why is because we are invigorated, we're fueled back up, and we're ready for the fight. And He likes to see us defeated. And so I want you to see, really, if they had listened to God and trusted God, they could have been in the promised land in 6 months. Amen. From this day that this is recorded, the whole thing could have been theirs. But they didn't, because they didn't trust God. And so this enemy comes out against them. And I want you to see that it says at the bottom, and took some of them prisoners. Now, you know what? There's a lot of God's people that's in prison this morning. Did you know that? Yeah. We're limited by what we say and by what we do and where we go and how we present. We're prisoners. And they were down. You know what? And the smallest little old thing can keep you a prisoner.
Yeah. Right.
I don't even have mine this morning. This is my wallet. I thought it was my cell phone. And I left it at home, and the kids said, Donna came and called over here in full panic that I left my phone at home. And you know what? That thing can hold you as a prisoner. Mm-hmm. Now, I wasn't tore up about it as she was, but I can see why she thought I would be. Because I do spend a lot of time doing this. And there's a lot of you that spend more than me doing it. Right? Amen or omega? And so we see then that we, as the Lord's people, you can be a prisoner to a lot of things. You can be a prisoner to your phone. You can be a prisoner to games. You can be a prisoner to movies. You can be a prisoner to your own home, and you just won't get out because you don't want to interact with people. That is being a prisoner. Now, that is where Satan would dearly love for you to stay. Is to be a prisoner. To do nothing that would accomplish anything for the glory and the honor of the Lord God Almighty. He would like you to stay even as you are. Notice verse 2. And Israel vowed a vow. Now let me say this. You be careful when you make a vow to the Lord God, because you'll be in under judgment if you don't keep it. You know what? We take church membership so lightly, don't we? You know what? When you united with this church, you made a commitment. What does the Bible say? How does Jesus look upon this church? It's like His wife, is it not? That's what the Bible says. It's His bride. And so if that be true, and it is, what about your commitment to this? You know, I made a vow to Donna somebody 30 years ago, and I intend to keep it. See, people don't approach marriage like that anymore, do they?
No.
They really don't. Now, has it all been peaches and cream? No. Me and Donna are both very hard-headed people, and I will be the very first to admit it. And you know what? You have to be committed to something. So when you make a vow, you better know what you're getting into. When you become a member to New Testament Baptist Church, listen, this ain't one of your little Southern Baptists. If you show up, good. If you don't, well, that's okay too. You know what? Be committed, because you know what? The Bible's true, and it says that we're bound together. When you go down, you drag me down with you. Right? And so then we, as the Lord's people, if you make a vow unto God, if you make a vow unto the Lord, plan to keep it. And Israel vowed a vow unto the Lord and said, if thou wilt indeed deliver this people unto my hand, then I will utterly destroy their cities. Now, I want you to see this. They were so concerned about the people in bondage that they got down to making a covenant with God. You know what? We're not concerned with people in bondage, are we? I ain't going to say who it was. I have a distant cousin. Found out he was a sodomite this week. Married a man back last year sometime. You know what that is? That's a bondage. You know, sin is a binding thing.
Yeah.
It takes control of your whole life. And whatever your besetting sin is, it will bring you down. And you know what? Instead of being upset about that, I need to be praying for a boy. I need to be praying that God might send someone his way and might deliver him somehow. Because you know what? I fully believe this. If he remains in that condition, life's never been spoken to him. And the only thing is a weary look at hell straight in the face. That's all it can be for him. And so, we need to pray for him.
Amen.
All these people you see in bondage, whatever it may be this morning, your responsibility is to be praying for them. And you can't pray if you're not in a condition. So they prayed, and then they extended that prayer, and they made covenant and said, if you'll deliver them, then we're going to take care of the entire problem. We're going to annihilate all their cities. You know what the problem is today? Is people don't stamp out sin. They don't get rid of the problem. They might address it a little bit, but as far as just taking it out of the way, they never do. You know what? Our churches would be a lot better off if we just did what was called for us to do, and if there's a problem, snip it out. Yeah. Prune the vine. Get rid of the problem. Right? And so they said, if you'll deliver, we'll go clear out all the land of Canaan. We'll annihilate them. We'll take everything that has breath. Notice verse 3, and the Lord hearkened to the voice of Israel and delivered up the Canaanites. That was a huge land. And utterly destroyed them and their cities. And he, meaning God, called the name of the place Hormah. And they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom. Now, I want you to notice two things. First of all, God gave them the victory, and they're ready to take on the next area. You know what the problem with Christians is today? They're never ready to take on the next area. If we claim to be missionary, and we do, then why aren't we at the next area? Why ain't there, why don't we get concerned about people down in Marshall County where there are no true churches? So they were willing to do that. They brought a great victory. The land of Canaan was now theirs, and they were going on it down to Edom. Now, I also want you to see that they were falling along the shores of the Red Sea. Now, what's the problem with seawater? You can't drink it. Or let me say this. You can't drink it without treatment. And that takes time. You can drink it. You just got to get the salt out of there. Right? Condensate it. And then that way you don't have to die. Now, see, sometimes serving the Lord takes time. Right? Do you want to take the time? I dare say many of us don't even want to take the 5 hours a week that we meet. And we meet longer than most groups. Right? And we don't even want to do that. You know, that shows a pretty pitiful approach to the God that gives us life, doesn't it? It really does. And so we find then that as Moses is recording this, that he says very plainly that their course took them by the Red Sea. Then notice, and the soul of the people. Now, I want you, what was the problems? They was tired. and they didn't have good drinking water. What type of problems are they? They're fleshly, right? They're fleshly. But then what does the next statement say? It says their soul. See, if we're not real careful, what is very temporal and very short-lived and over the span of life don't mean a whole lot, very, very, very easily it will impact the spiritual man. So it went from being hungry and not having plenty of good cold drinking water to impacting their spirit. You know what we need to do? We need to learn to draw the line and say, hey, that's a spiritual thing and this is a carnal thing, and I need to decide which one it's impacting. Now, with that said, let me say this, that one can't impact the other, and man, don't let your family go hungry in the name of Jesus. You know what I'm saying? I've seen these young preacher boys that won't hold a job, but their wife's out there at the nursing home and carrying on and trying to make a living for everybody, and then writing it off in the name of Christ. You know what that is? That's blasphemous.
Yeah.
Because the Bible says this, a man that provideth not for his family is worse than an infidel. And an infidel is a non-believer. One that's never been saved. And so we find then that their physical situation begins to impact their spiritual life. And that is very, very common. And the soul of the people was much discouraged. Why? Because of the way. Now you think about the most traumatic things that's happened recently, and you be real honest and tell me you haven't had a day or two of discouragement. What about faith? You know, we always want to humdrum like the Israelites did about us. What about Faith Baptist at Murray this morning? You know what? They're meeting without a pastor. They're meeting without a preacher this morning. What about Zora Baptist Church? They laid their pastor to rest 2 weeks ago. They don't have a pastor either. You see what I'm saying? They're people worse off than we are. But you know what? We get down so easily. You know what? It really doesn't matter how many people's meeting with us as long as God's meeting with us. Right? And so we find then that they get discouraged because the way is rough. You know what? I'm telling you this morning, I'm no health and wealth preacher, nor being the help of God will I ever be. You know what? Things are not going to get better. If some kind of charlatan TV preacher is telling you things are going to get just so good that God's going to take over, he's a liar and the truth's not in him. Things are going, the Bible literally says this, things will wax worse and worse. Now, does that sound like a group hug scripture to you? But it's true, is it not? And so we find then that they got discouraged because of the way. And listen, we will too. If we'd be real honest, we're going to get down and out at times. There's going to be hardships from time to time. There are going to be days you feel like quitting because of the way. Don't go to this step. And the people spake against God. And you know what? They did this more than once. Would to God we were back in Egypt. In fact, they said, would to God we were at the flesh pots of Egypt. But you know, when you look at their history, there was no flesh pot there. Leeks and garlics. Right? We kind of remember things the way we want to. Right? There's a family here in town. Won't say any names, but got caught in Granite City when the stock market fell. Fell in October, laid off from the sawmill the next Monday. Came back to a little two-room house down in Carlisle.
and they kind of thought they was uppity people. My great-grandmother took and shared what she had with them and got them through the first winter back home. And I say that to say this. They look back at the Depression, we all came together. Well, you know, this is the truth. People were starving to death.
Absolutely.
People was going without food and water. Children were being left on doorsteps. But they remembered it the way they wanted to, right?
And so we find here that they were thinking about Egypt and remembering what they wanted to about Egypt, but they didn't remember the whips, they didn't remember the beatings, they didn't get ready. Remember being smashed by the blocks to raise the pyramids. They didn't remember all that. And you know what? People remember sin the way they want to, don't they? You know what? If somebody rejoices back in their days of sin, you better watch them out. Won't say no names, but I loved him dearly. But one thing about the man I'm thinking of, he always talked about remembering drinking. And when he left the things of God, he went right back to it. Made me wonder, you know what I'm saying? Made me wonder. And so we then, as the Lord's people, don't revel in sin. Don't think about the goodness, which there is none, but don't think about your perceived goodness of sin. And the people spake against God and against Moses. Now, a lot of people will interpret this scripture, but they're not getting it right. They did not go to Moses with this event. Now, they did later on. They were just bad-mouthing him to each other. They never approached him. But you know what? God still knew, didn't he? God still understood. God was still aware. And you know what? You may think you have it all under hat, but you listen to me. God knows. God understands. He's fully aware. Even that idle, ungodly thought, he is understanding what we're saying. And the people spake against God and against Moses. Wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no bread, neither is there any water, and our soul loatheth this light bread. Now, first of all, they lied. There's no bread, but our soul hates this light bread. How can there be no bread and you hate what God's... You know what? People often hate what God's given them. You know why the doctrines of grace are hated? Because God gave them. And we want something we can do. We want a magical sinner's prayer. We want to be dunked. We don't want the simple grace and mercy of God. And you know why we don't want it? Because there's nothing we can do to control it. It's either there or it's not, right? And so they were hating something. Well, they were saying they didn't have nothing. And then they said they hated what they had. Sounds like pre-Baptist people to me. And the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much of Israel died. Now, don't miss this, because this is the judgment of God. That last part said, and much people died. You know what will happen if you are a true child of God, as Israel was, and you continue in rebellion? You're going to die. You can mark it down. And it won't be pleasant. Now, I also want you to think of this. He used available means. Now, can God open the earth's mouth and swallow people up? Sure he can. He did Korah and his band, didn't he? But what did he do this time? He took them fiery serpents and sent them right out. You know what? He uses available means. See, what we fail to do many times in the modern day is say, you know what? That was the mighty hand of God. The droughts and the fires in California, you can explain them away, and you talk about people thumping their cigarettes out the window, and anything you want to, but I'll tell you this, it's the mighty hand of God.
And the rains that came afterwards, and literally mudslides that took communities away, that was the mighty hand of God. And you can write her down and understand that, because you know what? You won't get that in a textbook. You won't get that off CNN. But that is the work of the mighty God of heaven. And so we find that as they are being judged, he uses the availability. He used the great fish in the judgment of Jonah. And you know, have you ever wondered this? I was thinking about this as I was preparing. He used the judgment. He used the same instrument as both the judgment and the preservation of Jonah. Very same instrument. And that was the great fish.
Right.
And so we find that these people were in full rebellion of God, and they received the judgment because of it. Verse 7, therefore the people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against thee." Now this is the first news, the best I understand it, that Moses had of it. Because see, they were running out through the camp. They wouldn't go to him and says, "You know what, Moses, we're hungry and it's your fault." They wouldn't do that. But they'd go around, "You know, we're going to starve to death out here listening to him. We ain't had nothing to drink in 4 days. We fixing that." They, you know what, like I said, they're just pre-runners to Baptists, ain't they? Just here and there and here. And so, Moses was unaware until judgment came. But you know someone that didn't get snake bit? Moses.
Right.
And you know why? Because he continued to trust God. And you know, in the day that we live today, who's going to not get snake bit? Those that continue to serve God. People that's taken down, that's taken of another way, that goes in a different direction. You know what the Bible says? He says, "They went out from us because they were not of us from the beginning." Taken out by the snakes, right? Got to be very careful of that in the modern day, because a lot of people want the easy street. People don't want to hear the Bible being preached as "Thus saith the Lord," but it is what it is. Second part of verse 7 says, "Pray unto the Lord that he take away the serpents from us." And Moses prayed for the people. Now, I want you to two things. They understood the effectiveness of prayer, and they knew that they couldn't pray. Now, don't y'all look at me like cows looking like a new barn door. But have you ever been in a condition where you can't pray? I know I have.
Yeah.
Every time it's my fault, but I've been there. That's why they said, "Moses, could you pray for us?" Because he was really the only one in any shape to pray. Right? And so we see that that's exactly what he did. And instead of being angry and upset and saying, "You know what? I don't care if a whole lot of you get killed by snakes. You was mouthing against me anyway," he prayed for him. Verse 8, "And the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent, and set it upon a pole, and it shall come to pass, that every one that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live." Now, I want you to get this. Now, everybody in here, I guess, knows I hate snakes. I don't care what kind of snake it is. I don't care if it's a black snake or how good they are and how good they are for your corn crib. I could care less. I hate snakes. I don't think they have any use whatsoever. I don't care how many rats they eat. But they were going to look on that to live. The very image of the sin itself. You know, where did sin get its start anyway? From a snake, right? Now, I don't know what he looked like before the fall, but I sure know what one looks like now. And you know, you have, and people say what they want, It's just crazy, you know. People have pet snakes these days. That's just stupid. Adam and Sarah had a bunch of snakes up there in that little house they bought. Had some guy come in and he wanted them. Took one of them home with him. You know what? The Bible says this, in the last days they shall lack natural affection. Right? I don't want a big snake in my house. That's stupid. It's just a natural aversion that's there. And if you kind of like them a little bit, I guarantee you if you hear that thing rattling, you ain't gonna like it long, right? And I'll tell you, if you're out in a berry patch and all of a sudden you smell cucumbers, you better run. Because you got your copperhead somewhere pretty close. You see what I'm saying? So the very thing that was the very image of judgment and sin, they had to look on it. You know what? If I'd been bit by a snake, and I'd never seen a bunch of people die from that, I'd be hard-pressed to look on another one, wouldn't you? But that's what Christ did for us. Took on the very image of sin. I've heard some people try to say that Jesus was a good-looking man. I don't believe it. He probably was as ugly as I am, or more ugly, if that's possible. Because the Bible says this, he was without form or comeliness. And you know what? Snake images are not nice. They're not pretty. They're not attractive to look at. But that's what they had to look at if they wanted divine healing. So if you will ever experience salvation, you'll have to look on Christ as your answer to sin, or you'll never be saved. Nothing that you can do. See, now, let me ask you this. You read the rest of that text. Were they ever to cry out the sinner's prayer to the snake? Just look on it. Just look on it. You know what? If you ever look on Christ and see him for who he is, your breath will be taken away. If you see him ever as the full atonement, the complete answer to sin, the most vile sin you've ever committed, and you look on him as the full answer, that's all you ever. And you know what? What baptism is, just fade right on into the background. Because what you do is you stand in the person of Christ. These people had to stand and look on the snake for their divine healing. And they did. And it was accomplished. And he did it. Now go and read the Gospel of John chapter 3. Everybody thinks about 3:16, but we're going to go in a little bit before that. John chapter 3 and verse 9. John chapter 3 and verse 9. The Bible says this, Nicodemus answered and said unto him, how can these things be? And what he had said, he put the Jewish religion on its back. He said, Nicodemus, you've got to be born again. And you know what? There's nothing you can do to be born. There's not one thing that you contributed to your natural birth. You didn't request to be born. You didn't ask if it could be a certain day. You didn't talk to mom and dad about it. Why? Because you couldn't. You weren't there yet. In the very same way, he said, Nicodemus, you must be born again. You can't do this. Your religion's not good enough. You're being a devout Jew has left you high and dry. You must be born again. You know what? If you've not been regenerated, if you've not been saved, all you'll do is when you're baptized, go down there dry and come up wet and still have no relationship whatsoever with God. See, we need to understand the danger of religion. We need to understand the danger of falsehood. Of somebody telling you to repeat a prayer and the foolishness that goes with that. Because that's what Nicodemus had to give up. And Nicodemus answered and said unto him, how can these things be? Jesus answered and said, art thou a master of Israel and knowest not these things? Verily, verily, I say unto thee, we speak what we do know and testify what we have seen.
that we have seen, and you receive not our witness? If I've told you of earthly things, and you believe it, and you believe not, how shall you believe if I tell you of heavenly things? And no man ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man, which is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Now, in addition to certainly being on the cross, he had to look like us. He had to be encapsulated in a, well, and I'll say this, and the older I get, you know, I used to hear old preachers say, well, the older I get, I think the less I understand. And I, you know, when you're 26 and you know everything, you think that's kind of stupid. But I kind of get it now. And I'll be 50 in December. But it says he was in the likeness of sinful flesh. He looked like us. He was tried like us. But he wasn't like us. His Father was God, sinless and holy and beautiful and righteous. So in the likeness of sinful flesh, he understood sin, yet he knew no sin. He understood what the trials of this flesh was about, yet he never had one. Can you imagine never even having one idle thought? I cannot perceive that. And as hard as I might, I just cannot understand. I will one day, I guess.
That's right. Amen.
But I can't perceive that. I really can't. But that's how he lived. And then certainly he defeated the flesh in doing that. And then he was raised up. That's why he had to say, was it to Peter or John? You take mother into your house. You take care of her. I personally believe that Joseph was dead. And as the oldest son, he had took on the care of Mary. And he knew he was going to be gone. And that was the Jewish law. So he needed somebody to pick that up for him. And he did it. Completely fulfilled the law. Completely done it. His body completely macerated and hanging above all of them, he fulfilled exactly what he was supposed to do and did it in a wonderful and marvelous way. Gospel of John chapter 12, verse 23. Gospel of John chapter 12, verse 23. The Bible says, and Jesus answered them saying, the hour's come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Now I want you to get this real close, because he knew it was time. All the way along the way, he had a timetable set and he met every engagement. When he stayed behind in Jerusalem and his mother and daddy headed back home, and he was there some 3 days before they even knew he was missing. And remember what he said? He said, I must be about the Father's business. He had to teach. He had things to do. And so when he said the hour's now come, he knew it was one. He knew the very minute where he was at in this timetable. You know what? If nothing don't happen in the morning. Now, my job, I don't have to be there at a certain time, really, but I generally get to work between 7:30 and 8. I'm supposed to be there by 8. But you know, people that punch clocks, they don't have that deviation time. They got to be there. You know what? And in the nursing jobs I've had and other jobs I had where I did punch clock, if we were late, we got deducted. Do y'all? If you, at 8:01... it went to 8:15, right? And so you lost time. That's what we call it. You lost time. All along his way, he was right on time. Every event. You know what? Down to Cana of Galilee, when he turned the water on into wine, it was right on time. Exactly the moment. Remember, Mary came to him and said, they have no wine. And
he says, my time's not yet come. But it must have come right in there because he did it in a minute and they had the best wine they ever had. You know why? Because he did it perfectly. Every moment, every instant, he did it. And that's how we should see. Verse 24, verily, verily, I say unto you, except the corn of wheat fall to the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. He that loveth his life shall lose it. Now, you let that one sink in really, really good. If you love life, and I'm not talking about just, you know, I don't know anybody looks forward to dying. But if the allurements of this world, if you love them more than God, you're going to lose your life. Because what's going to happen is one morning you're going to wake up and you're going to be 40 or 50 and you've wasted everything in promotion of self. You've wasted everything in whether it be cars or homes or whatever it may be. You've wasted your energies in doing something that has no spiritual value whatsoever, has no eternal value. That's what it means, you know, because I've seen a lot of people, well, I know Aunt Sally, she was supposed to be saved, and she went out, and all she ever did was act like this and act like this, and she never repented. You know, the only thing I can say about that, if she was saved, she lost her life. Now, she may not have died immediately, but you know what? Aunt Sally had a pretty miserable, poor life, right? You can lose your life and live, right? You can still be alive and have no value whatsoever to the things of God. And we see that a lot in modern day. And so he that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If any man serve me, let him follow me. Where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour, but for this cause came I into this hour. Father, glorify thy name. So what was his prayer? To be delivered? Certainly not. He said, that's why I came this direction. He said, the only thing I say is glorify your name. And you know where he received the glory? Is Jesus being sent. And so that's exactly what happened. So this morning, where are you at in all this? Where do you abide? What is your position? How well do you see them? See, they could not necessarily see any victory in Jesus dying, but that was the only victory. How well do you see him? When things happen to us unexpectedly, how do you see him? When the news is not good, how do you see him? When something's wrong with your children, how do you see him? When things don't work out on the workplace like you think they should, how do you see him? See, that's an incredible question to answer this morning, is how do you see Christ? Do you see him defeated? You know, for years and years, I heard, till I almost believed it, well, I guess I did believe it for a while, that Jesus is trying to save you. Well, you know what? If you see him like that, you don't see Christ. Do you know what? He's never tried anything that he wasn't successful at. It's truth, isn't it? And so, how do you see him? You know what? Even on the worst day, I see him victorious. When I get bad news, I have to ask him and say, Lord, where are you at in this? Sometimes I have to say, you know, what is your plan? But I know that it's there. How do you see him this morning? Do you see him King of Kings and Lord of Lords?
I've heard a lot of people say that that's what will be on his waistband and running down the thigh of his leg there in the valley of Jehoshaphat. King of kings and Lord of lords, do you see him that way? Well, if you do, you have to be obedient. Do you see him as someone that's trying to do something? Do you see him as second dibs when all else has failed? I guess I'll try to pray. That didn't work out too much for Moses' people, did it? So what, how do you see him? This is how I see him this morning. I see him in the throne room, high and lifted up. But I don't see him that way every day. But you know what? Every day that is where he's at. And we just need to remember that, do we not?
Right.